the other side, there's one, two areas where we're actually submitting the same housing strategy. It's the same there, but all in all, it's £895,000 of forecast for the open 20th year. There's another savings option, we've got three at the moment, I'm kind of rated red. We've got savings between blue and the low, it's green on track, April savings, and our red ones. Three red ones basically support that we mentioned before, but it's on track. Golfing come down at 40,000 and Sioux Central lease up about £1,000 for both, look at that, £650,000. In terms of savings that we've done so far, we've achieved 52% of savings at part of each stage, so we're slightly ahead in terms of the calendar period. Some savings that come on day one, some savings come at the end of the year, so it's more working on that area. Okay. Going through the page, 3.4 on report. So I noticed that was an error. In 3.41, I said I was 1.1 million in debt outstanding, that's 746,000 for the committee. That is in table 4. Analysed over the length of the debt. 255,000 pounds, that is less than 30 days old. As soon as we see the invoice, that's our box of debt. And then people going out 50 days to pay. So that's the
Could you just say what it's meant to be on table?
So it's at 746,000, sorry, it fits right at the table. In the narrative, I said 3.41, I said 1.1 million, that relates to environment, it's now to the book of authority. Sorry, what I had. Okay, that's where it's in. 3.5 on capital programme, there's been quite a lot of change in the capital programme in the year. So we've reprogrammed halfway each stage, looked at the schemes. And it's dropped quite considerably in terms of the programme. Some of this is moving to future years, in terms of the programme, and some of this dropped out. The biggest change though is the BIFA contract with BIFA vehicles. At the beginning of the year, we had a bonus from BIFA to finance some of the vehicles, and we'd make a small profit. We'd be sort of interest rate, etc. We would buy the vehicles, listen to them in some kind of income, which is more than £1,000 at the end of the year, etc. This had a kind of change in ownership and the way to run. They've got a whole better finance themselves, and that's kind of fallen away. So that's no longer seen. That's their kind of commercial decision. But it just means our capital program drops by 5.7 million. We lose perhaps some potential income we could have got if we would have helped against our account based contract. But that's their decision. Okay. There's a few other changes. Clearance schemes, £1.1 million reduction, and that's been reprogrammed out to 18-19. So the work will still take place, which will be in 18-19 rather than. Well, 17-18. And there's less of a sort of change that's taking place to the profile of capital schemes. The capital programme is actually detailed in Appendix A. If you want to see what's actually in the programme. So the revised programme now is £6.4 million capital spend. Of that, about half of it, £3.25 million, comes from what we call council resources. That's the council basically borrowing money to fund those schemes. And the other half comes from grants, fixed type grants. So that's sort of the funding of the programme. At the early stage, at this stage of the year, we spent £1.7 million on capital against a £6.4 million programme and revised figure. Again, it's slightly low, but I think traditionally the capital spend takes place towards the end of the year. So we need to push that on. And that's probably the summation of how the report. Happy to take any questions.
And we're beginning to sound like broken working. So on page 37, you talk about the income levels of the golf course continuing to fall below target. Do you know why? Because you don't collect any money. It's kind of a simple thing. So I'd like to ask, through you, Chair, can we please find out how many people use, and I will use the example of Brackenwood Golf Course, how many people used it, how much money was collected, how many people were on there who weren't paying because they'd come on in the middle of the golf course? Now, this is something I've been asking for 5 years, and when I worked for Ben Chapman, we can go back a further 15 years. It was pointed out to me as well by one of my colleagues down the table that the new notice says about Brackenwood Golf Course, please keep off the grass. So that exactly you can hear everybody's play golf, there's nothing to do. So I'm asking that, and I want that information, please, because I'm fed up and bored with asking. I'm sure everybody else in this room is fed up and bored with me asking. But if you don't collect the money, how on earth are you going to have an income?
Yeah, I should speak to Leisure Commons about that, because it's their budget and their processes, so I'll speak to them and see what they wish to talk about.
Chair, could I ask, because I've already asked that question on numerous occasions and was actually going for an FOI in there, could I ask that this is time limited? In fact, if that question is asked, that we have an answer back within a set time, which is sent to every single member of this committee. And that's limited. Well done.
Right, Christine, could you just define what you mean by do you want prior to the next committee?
Yeah, let me answer that. Sorry,
sorry, respect, Mark, you can't answer my question. I would like the answer back by the end of January.
First, the council must back. My recollection is there was a very clear action at the last committee meeting provide a briefing note talking around the detail of this issue. It should have happened by now. If it hasn't, I will go back, and on the basis that it was an action from the last meeting that might not have been actioned, I will take it away as an urgent priority to get that information provided, because it was raised at the last committee and I'm fully aware of that.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Mark, for that. Could I ask if we have the answer back by the end of January 2018? That is minuted. We all want a copy of it, please. I know it will be boring for Bracklewood, but I'm sure it applies to lots of other golf courses as well. And I think I have been asking this for 5 years, so I'm pleased Mark's noticed it's the last meeting. It's been a lot longer than that.
Chair, the only problem with that is we've missed all the information that's gone because you haven't thought anyone in the past. You've got to actually monitor us over the next few weeks to see who's going on there and who's not paying that money.
Can I just say they've obviously been doing that? Oh, I have a fair idea, so we'll just see.
It's expensive for this committee to decrease to that. By the end of January, we'll have just now reassurance from Mark that we won't be waiting that long.
That's just good rather than.
It's an all caps loan golf course. Thank you. Bruce Burnett.
Thank you, Chair. On page 41, capital programme and funding, the sixth item up from the bottom, which says clearance, and the revised budget is £200,000. And there's a grant for £200,000. Can you tell me, can you explain what clearance is? Is this property clearance?
Yes, it could be property clearance schemes. Yes. So.
That's what it is. Okay, thank you.
Just an item 3.3.3. Give a little bit more detail than there's a part of this. About what the actual 0.4 million overspend was in regards to the waste contract. And also, it mentioned in the next point down about the leisure centre income being down. That's got an investigation going on, so will this committee see sight of that investigation report at the end? And then the third point, assuming that Christina's massive people bumping out of the golf courses aren't actually costing us that much. Another golf course at Point Hill. If we're going to keep that successful, given the declining golf across the world, that's just a comment.
There's an investigation in the 10th place. Look at the options, what's happening in terms of income. So we can send you both back to you. That's what we're finding. So, when I say investigation, I mean, I don't think it's a form of a case of subject. It's a case of, you know, obviously, we've got a number of variances of why this variance taking place. What are the reasons? That's something well, that. Okay. I think in terms of the waste of waste contract and the market, I might be telling you more close to that area. I think there's a question we negotiate some terms, get a better deal. I think some of this process is taking place, it's taking long to realise.
So the principle is both of those items, the 400,000 for the waste contract and the 800,000 for the sports and recreation, they were new budget options that were taken. So they were changes that were supposed to give us financial efficiencies. So the one amount for contract, the idea was that we had this large contract of significant value. And the idea was that we would work a bit to drive out efficiency savings from that, back office efficiencies in the way we do the business. And the challenge that we've had is that when we try to work a bit to do that, we've struggled to do that. So the latest position on that is that Nikki Butterworth, who heads up our commissioner support team, she now manages that bit of the contract, and she's looking at, as we mentioned there, alternative ways of delivering that. Saving. The £800,000, again, it's about the leisure business in improving its financial position, either through improving efficiency or bringing in more income. And as we've said there, there have been challenges in delivering that and making that change. So that's where the pressure is coming from.
Could I ask, just clear what you mean by the struggle to do that, have they resisted any change, is that what you're saying?
I think the plan was, when we implemented the option, from a client side, we identified potential ideas and options and looked at the value of the contract. We identified some ideas as to how we might do that, but then it's worked out in practice that when we then have those detailed technical discussions with BIFA, obviously that hasn't come to fruition. So it has been partly dependent on, we've had ideas from the client side, but then when we've worked that through the operational detail and got that expert view from their side, obviously they're saying that, it hasn't been possible to improve those efficiencies, particularly in a way which doesn't affect standards of service delivery out there. So, as I said, we're not just taking that position at that, we're continuing to work with BIFA and look at all the ways of delivering those services on the contract. And it's now the interest within the team that doing that.
Just to follow up on that, Mark, when the actual budget option was put together, was there not work with BIFA in advance to say, is this the level before it comes to the administration agree on something?
Yeah. We at that stage we were we did some very preliminary work around potential savings areas, and some of that was obviously based on technical views of offices within the council client offices. It's only then when we've got into that detail of working that through with our expert contractor that we've not been able to achieve those savings. So
was that you did it with BIFA in advance?
No, we didn't, because we have a contractual relationship with BIFA, so we've only been able to take forward those ideas and discussions so far in a formal way, without, importantly, having the council's approval to actually progress with an action.
Sorry, I'm
trying
to ask a better question. So what you're saying is these efficiency savings were identified by the council without engaging with BIFA first and then put forward as a saving, but without actually agreeing that with BIFA until after it was put forward as a saving. Just trying to understand how the council can identify a saving when they're not delivering the service and they're not contracting to it and they haven't engaged.
We had preliminary discussions with with this around ways of making savings, and this isn't necessarily just recently, this is over time, so this is based on the contracts that have been in place since 2006, so we have a good local technical and operational knowledge of that contract and the issues associated with it. So, based on that information, that knowledge, we've spoken to BIFA, but we've come up with those ideas which have had to be from the council and the client side. So we then believe that, once the option is taken, that we get into the detailed discussions with BIFA around the practicalities of how we implement changes. So we could only go so far with those discussions because it's a contractual relationship that we have.
Okay, thank you. I've got Ian and Chris.
Thanks, thank you. It was going back to page 37, item 3.3.3, fourth bullet point. It reaches as good news, perhaps I can just get some more information for the chair through you. It says there is a highways management is reporting a £100,000 underspend due to increased demand for professional services in relation to third party developments, which has led to additional income. Can the director or one of his colleagues explain, in terms of that underspend, are we then looking to reinvest that in additional highways maintenance measures, or what happens to that underspend, and also what is the nature of the professional services that we've seen an increase in, and is that something we can explore further as we go forward to next year's budget?
Yeah, for you, Chair, I don't know whether Pete may have some detail. I think what that will be that will be members of David Ball's team on the management regulatory side. So it could be relating to client applications or something like that. I need to go away and just get the detail of that if Pete doesn't know.
Chair, no, I don't have detail. But what's in terms of that extra income, of course, about the overspend situation in terms of the council? So in a way that better position there, yeah, that we have offset that. Okay. But obviously we're going through the national budget means work whether that can be exploited, but instead of built in and help next year.
Okay, thanks. Be specific on this one. The report states highways management is reporting a £100,000 underspend due to increased demand for professional services. That implies that the services are related to highways management, and therefore, what happens to that underspend? That's the question. Does it go back? I'm not looking for a right or wrong answer, just the answer. Does that underspend go back into the pot, as Pete's explained, or is that underspend spent on additional highways maintenance?
For you, Chair, as Pete explained, that £100,000 is a relatively modest size figure. That just becomes part of the overall. In the budget line in David Ball's area, who's the assistant director for that, and he just manages pressures and demands, etc., in that to come in with a balanced budget. So it just stays within that area and becomes part of the overall picture, as Pete described.
Okay, thank you.
Chris
and Tony.
Thanks, Chair. Page 39, second bullet point. Which council officer will possibly give me an answer to this, or we might have a way to find one. It does state that it aids in adaptations to the DFGs, which is the disability fund allowance, £1.1 million reduction. Spend is influenced by a number of external factors, such as the extent, complexity, and value of the adaptations required. And due to this, the programme has been reprofiled down. I'd like to know how it's been reprofiled, because the nature of the beast on this one is that the costs go up, not down. Adaptations. So does it mean that we're only going to, I think the cap for these at the moment is 30k, am I right?
Yeah.
So does it mean that we're going to lower the cap on that for individuals, or does it mean that we're going to cut certain standards of work that we do for the adaptations? I'd just like to know how it's been profiled down in 18 and 19.
Through Chair, I think we're profiling is looking at work, that's going on the books, how much we stick to deliver. I think some of the funding has been moved to 2019. So it's basically no one's been lost as such.
Right.
It just has to be spent rather than not only be spent in 2018, it has to be spent in 2018-19 instead. Right. Based on the program balance.
Okay.
Yeah.
Tony Smith.
Just two very quick questions. Volume must be on 3.33. At the end of it, I would be a little bit concerned. What's a small amount of money that we're going to be saving on homelessness? And seem to be vacancies in the environment, considering the sort of problems we have in the area and that. So, are we trying to recruit people or are we just reading that? I mean, I'm trying to read it, it's a very small sum of money. But my other question, I'd like to see perhaps if there is vacancies in that area and if we have a problem here in the world, which I think we do have, that, we do fill those vacancies as quickly as possible. My other question is, the overspend, how does that compare to previous years at this time of the year?
Yeah, I've got quite a match on that question we were last year, and I'll put to the committee, I've got that figure available. Yeah. Okay. And in terms of just homelessness, obviously we haven't got a vacancy freeze at the moment at all, so all those that are vacant can be advertised. So I don't think that's what's worth it. There's no posh to hold those vacancies as such. So, but what you may find is people leave 6,500 in place, and that can be the same.
Okay, so any more questions? Okay, this committee happy to make the report.
Approach towards the dog filing, and if you're caught, we will be fined. authority we've issued since the 1st of July 2015 in excess of 20,000 litter notices, and since we brought Kingdom on board to enforce the dog file on the 9th of May last year, we've issued 311 dog file litter penalty notices. Enforcement action. Take action, provide deterrent, improve quality of life. The decision was taken to engage a private enforcement agency following the insight survey back in 2015. Being tried with limited resources and limited success in catching the perpetrators. We realised we needed to tackle environmental crime because it was high on the residents' agenda. Litter enforcement was chosen as our starting point in all of this. We had a flexible contract that allowed us to learn from issues and develop the contract, which I'll come on to later, where we took our dog family and our way jumping enforcement. We supported this with extensive educational campaigns around litter, dog fouling and any other environmental crime. We're all looking at enforcement. Kingdom Services Group Limited were our successful bidder to the tender, and we then awarded the contract to Kingdom for a term of 2 years plus 1 year from the 1st of July 2015. Litter enforcement was deemed our key priority in starting all of this. Again, we had extensive marketing and promotional pre-go live messages went out, and our zero tolerance approach to all of this environmental crime was high on the agenda. The contract actually requires only a minimum of 4,000 days for litter fix penalty notices per annum, and for the contractor to provide 4 full-time dedicated enforcement officers. There's no fixed unpayment process in respect of litter and dog fouling. We're all pay Kingdom on a fixed penalty notice amount for each fixed penalty notice that they issue. Where the case escalates to court, Kingdom retain the agreed payment of the initial fixed penalty notice amount. An officer performs, which I'm sure Sandra will come on to later, is appraised through competency following the review of the total approach to providing the service, the appearance, the attitude to public and professionalism. It was enforcement. Wirral Council versus Kingdom. We undertook reactive litter enforcement. Ad hoc, with only 4 dedicated officers full-time that also tackle fly tipping, dog fouling, abandoned vehicles, untidy property and land, etc. In reality, Kingdom provide 8 dedicated, fully trained enforcement officers which patrol in all areas of the borough, targeting our litter and dog foul hotspots. That was it, in areas with significant footfall activity. And there's no dilution of Kingdom's work. That's what they're trained to do and that's what they do. Before we embarked on the zero tolerance approach, our instructions was to display leniency when issuing fixed penalty notices, and the perpetrators were provided with an opportunity to pick up. They were given the relevant advice, etc. Kingdom, we adopted the zero tolerance approach, and now perpetrators are given no opportunity to pick up, and all offenders are issued with a fixed penalty notice. Representations that may be made following those fixed penalty notices being issued are dealt with by Kingdom as a first point of contact. Council officers, we use antiquated and cumbersome systems to issue tickets. It was basically paper and pen. We have no reliable facility to check information given by offenders as they were given the ticket. In reality, Kingdom use those handheld computer terminals to issue on-the-spot fines. All conversations with offenders are recorded via CCTV equipment, which we can review at any time. The ability to immediately contact our back office systems, and now I understand that further, and there's a system on the handheld computer terminal that verifies identity I'm sure Sam will talk about that later, and they have reliable offender information, and therefore the tickets have been reliably issued. Obviously, council officers were limited to availability, resource and time for other services to be added, something which would drop off. Kingdom contract is flexible to allow variation for incorporation of other key environmental priorities, mainly dog farming and passageway jumping, which I know was referred to earlier, and now dealt with by Kingdom. Again, number of dedicated officers, we had 4. Kingdom had 8 at the start of the contract, with 10, including 2 dog farming officers, which all wear the same hat, litter and dog fouling. So if they spot a litter offence, they'll issue for that. If they spot a dog fouling offence, they'll issue for that. Number of fixed penalty notices for littering offences. We're all issued 92 in 5 years, from 2010 to 2015. Kingdom issued from July 2015 to present 23,498 litter penalty notices, which is astounding. You could never have envisaged when we started on this, that number of fixed penalty notices. Successful payment rate of the fixed penalty. We did have a discount up until last April, but the discount's now gone. We attained a 34% payment rate. Kingdom attained a 72.8% payment rate. Defra guidance is a 75% payment rate, so we're not far behind that. Number of successful prosecutions resulting in convictions. I don't have those figures pre-Kingdom. From November 2015, when we started prosecuting the litter fixed penalty notices, to date, we've successfully prosecuted 5,685 perpetrators through the courts. Passageway jumping, which I'll come on to later. The passageway jumping wasn't all about issuing litter fixed penalty notices. It was about engendering the behavioural change and wanting people to do the right thing and dispose of the waste correctly via our waste systems. For that, we didn't issue any litter fixed penalty notices before Kingdom came on board. We've now issued 811 litter fixed penalty notices for alleyway dumping. We've only got a small payment rate. That's due to this being on circumstantial evidence. So that's attaining an 11.8% payment rate. And we've referred 214 people for prosecution through the magistrates. The magistrates fully support our alleyway dumping campaign. They are appalled at what they see is dumped in the alleyways when we bring these perpetrators to court. This just shows a graph of from April 2016 up through to September 2017. When we first embarked, it shows the number of litter fixed penalty notices per month. We had a spike back in from June to September and November. As the behavioural changes kicked in and people are doing the right thing, the number of litter fixed penalty notices has dropped, which is something that we fully expected to happen. This next graph shows the number of fixed penalty notices issued for dog fouling. Kingdom have got clever. We started off and we had low numbers, but as the campaign has progressed, those numbers have got higher, because Kingdom, and I'm sure Sam will explain later, have become better at detecting these crimes. Complete learning curve for both the council and Kingdom. Variations to the initial contract. On the 1st of April 2016, we varied the contract to include 2 dedicated full-time enforcement officers to tackle our alleyway dumping. That was to encourage the behavioural change and establish residents' barriers to presenting the waste correctly for collection. Obviously, that included the issuing of litter fixed penalty notices in accordance with our zero tolerance approach. This added great value to the initial contract. On the 9th of May, we brought dog fouling on board with Kingdom. That was a variation, and we asked Kingdom to issue a minimum of 131 fixed penalty notices per programme, which they've smashed that figure. That was based on 1.5% of the overall figure of the list of fixed penalty notices issued in the first instance. That was proved across a number of councils that Kingdom were already operating in. The principal aim of the contract is obviously behavioural change, residents' perception and the achievement of our Wirral plan. We did make a surplus in 15-16, which we've reinvested into environmental services, which I'll come on to on another slide. The condition of the surplus is that it is reinvested into environmental improvements and measures that will help us achieve our priorities and objectives. Other areas of enforcement have been introduced and improved through reinvestment, such as the passageway jumping and the neglected private land. The part of the reinvestment was into our rock spots, which I'm sure members will be aware of, and neglected private lands. We invested £40,000 per annum, 2015-16 and 2016-17 into that. We also introduced a quite hard-hitting dog fouling video. I don't know if any of you have seen it. That was at a cost of £5,000. We provided extra litter bins, because that's what people wanted to see on the street. That cost us £8,000. Love Where You Live, the press and PR, that cost us an initial £60,000 to launch. And obviously we invest in volunteer projects which are important to us, equipment and support, litter fixes, bags, waste collection, etc. The fixed penalty notice income was reinvested into our grot spots. The public perception of street scene often was influenced by neglect of privately or unowned land, which was out of council control. The land management clearance provision was incorporated into a new graffiti and flight posting contract. That was for the work to be undertaken in default should somebody or not comply with the notice or we didn't go through a certain parcel of land. We used appropriate legislation to require landowners to clear the land. Where there was non-compliance with the formal notice, the council would clear the land and seek to recover those costs. We keep the public informed of our progress and successes throughout media and social media feedback. Just coming on to some rock spots, this was a particular blight on our location. It attracted antisocial behaviour, there was street drinking, drugs use, etc. This was some land that was not owned by anybody, it was unregistered. We'd had lots of complaints about the antisocial behaviour, so we went in and served notice on that land and undertook the clearance. And that's what it looks like now. We knocked the building down so that the perpetrators couldn't hide in that small building and do what they were doing. That came in at a cost of £4,350 to clear that portion of land. One of our main successes where we haven't had to take any action is, I don't know if you know it, Davis Street, which is in our bid location, was blighted with 80 tonnes of hazardous waste dumped on that particular portion of land. Through no formal notices and threat and court action, etc., we eventually got the landowners to comply, and that's what it looks like now. If the council had to undertake the works in default on that particular portion of land, it would come in at a cost of £28,000. The dog fouling enforcement campaign video. It was used to support our zero tolerance approach towards dog fouling. It was a professionally commissioned video through a local company. It features local people and community organisations, and we published that extensively on social media. That was to make it more high profile. Our contract was due to come to an end on the 30th of June 2017, but because the contract had performed so well over the preceding 2 years, a decision was made to extend that contract for a further year until the 30th of June 2018. This gives us an opportunity to explore other enforcement opportunities that we may. may wish to see happening in the future. It's overall a hugely successful model, and we're now starting to see defined improvements in local environmental policy. You only have to walk down, which was one of my pet heads, Grange Road in Birkenhead, to see all the discarded cigarette stubs all over the pavement, getting in the gutters, getting into the tree guards, which took us an awful lot of time to clear. You do not see that now. You see people smoking, but they go and use the bin. I've heard people sat on benches and saying to other people, don't litter your cigarette, but put it in the bin, otherwise you'll be fined. So the message is getting out there. This is something that we've, is not going to be launched until the new year, so that you're the first members to see this. It's a weather mapping system, which Kingdom and Kindly worked on relentlessly with us, and their computers now talk to our computers. And this shows all the locations, our hotspot locations, with the number of tickets. I'm just going to go into the live version, and fingers crossed it's working. This is what it's going to look like when it goes live. So this shows 17,185 litter fixed penalty notices. If we zoom in, that gives us more in-depth information into each location, so that we can see exactly how many tickets have been issued and in what locations. As you'd expect, Birkenhead has got a higher total than other people, more concentrated football, etc. I think if we move in, yeah, that shows us even more detail, moving even closer. But as well as this, we're planning now to overlay patrol routes coming in the new year that will show anybody, members of the public, who want to look at it, exactly where our patrol patterns are, so you can see where officers are, where they patrol, etc. So that is a great addition to the contract. And thank you to Kingdom for working hard on that. That's the end of my presentation. Do you want to give questions till later, or would you like to ask any questions now?
I was going to suggest that we listen to Kingdom first, because then if there's any questions, of both can answer at the same time.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Chair.
Back to Sandra.
Keep on progressing and get all this information out.